it's been a long, long time. How am I doing? Oh, I guess that I'm doing fine. It's been so long now, and it seems that it was only yesterday. Gee, ain't it funny how time slips away?
The purpose of our organization is to provide a source of information for our members' business needs, such as professional contacts, career opportunities, and industry-related education. Thank you. This year, EnSource's continued effort to provide a source of industry-related education, we established the Foundation Award to recognize women who played a vital role in the Nashville music industry and paved the way for us today. This evening, we recognize some of the women who worked in the industry in the 1950s, 1960s, and the early part of 1970. I'd like to take this time to introduce the Foundation Award Committee members who worked tirelessly to make our first awards dinner possible. Would each of you please stand when I call your name? Judy Harris. Pat Roth, Arita Schneider, Barbara Turner, and Judy Turner. In addition, I'd like to thank Tina Camp's Decoration Committee and the Source members who gave of their time and talents. Would y'all please stand? Also, thanks to Karen Clark and Lori Stone at SunTrust Bank and their Source members for all of their hard work in keeping our money straight. Very important. And a very special thank you to our sponsors and vendors, for without their generosity, this evening would not have been possible. We would appreciate everyone paying special attention to the back of your program for these special people's names. Also, I'm very excited about this. I'd like to tell everyone about our website and invite everyone to check us out. And thank you, Judy Newby and Grace Reinball, for making this possible. www.sourcenashville.com. Now, since our mayor, Bill Purcell, has left the building, by the way, thank you, Dr. Emma Flowers, for personally inviting our mayor. I would like to introduce the unofficial mayor of Music Row and our host this evening, Charlie Monk.
This is not going to last long because I have to go pee. For those of you that do not know me, I have a disclaimer to make. I am not a stand-up comic. I am an intellectual humorist. So if you don't laugh at everything I say, the other people at your table will think you're a dumbass. I dreamed I was there in hillbilly heaven. Oh, what a beautiful sight. Shh. Last night I dreamed I went to hillbilly heaven. Guess who met me at those pearly gates? It was Waymore himself, Waylon Jennings. He said, "Welcome, Hoss." He called me Hoss like I was the first person he ever called Hoss. He said, "Hoss, you scared me there for a minute. I thought you were Mike Curb," and he would want to change the name to the Curb Pearly Gates. He said, "Let me show you around. Some of your old pals will be glad to see you." He said, "I'm sorry the big guy couldn't meet you. It was time for his guitar lessons with Chet Atkins, and nobody would miss that." The first person we ran into was Gentleman Jim Reeves. He and Patsy Cline were having a little wine and unleavened bread. They said they wished that RCA and MCA would stop releasing them damn demos. We overheard Hubert Long and Shorty Lavender trying to put together a 10-act package show. Hubert said he heard about Bill Anderson's alleged domestic altercation with a woman about half his age. Johnny Russell walked up and said he didn't know that Whispering Bill could still do it. The sheriff, fair and young, tapped me on the shoulder and asked if I knew what Merlin Littlefield and Elroy Kahanic used for birth control. I said no. He said, hell, they use their personalities. Conway Twitty walked up and said, hello, Charlie. He asked me if I still referred to Mike Borchetta as full of Shetta. I looked up and saw a big billboard with a smiling face of my former boss at ASCAP, Ed Shea. Right under Ed's picture was a sign that read, Connie Bradley is a whole ASCAP. Pat Roth is kind of a half ASCAP. Red Savine pulled up in his Phantom 309, and I told him his son Roger had quit BMI and moved to Gulf Shores, Alabama. Red said Roger never did anything at BMI. It looked like Paul Corbin was doing about half of that. Serious. Waylon took me into a little back room where a few guys were playing poker. Len Schultz, David Skepner, Harlan Howard, and Colonel Bill Hall. Skepner was explaining what was wrong with heaven. Schultz was telling Harlan what changes he should have made in Heartaches by the Number. And the colonel was dozing at the table. Harlan said he was tickled that his child bride was keeping his name out front. Schultz asked me if I remembered the names of Larry Butler's wives. He said he remembered the first one, then 8, 9, and 10. Then I heard dom, 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 dom. I looked over and saw the man that helped create that sound, Luther Perkins, sitting on the park bench with the man in black along with June Carter Cash and members of the famous Carter family. I congratulated John on his very deserving award at the Video Music Awards. John said I was sick, but the real reason I didn't go to that show was they wanted me to sing with Snoop Doggy Dogg and 50 Cent and finish with an open mouth kiss. I asked Waylon if I could meet Hank Williams since I had the pleasure of meeting Audrey. Waylon said Hank was out on the Celestial Lake fishing and trying to figure out how in the hell his son became Hank Jr. when his real name was Randall. Waylon inquired about Bo Cephas' health, said a couple of years ago Hank Jr. was concerned about his height, thought he was getting shorter, and thought it was caused by that awful accident. Waylon said it was probably caused from all those years of Hank Jr. having to carry Merle Kilgore. Super Agent Buddy Lee asked if I knew why Mike Milam, Jim Zumwalt, Joel Katz, and other music business lawyers didn't have sex with their clients. I said, no, why? Buddy says it was to prevent the client from being billed twice for the same service. Jack Stapp said he heard about the CMA controversy, them wanting diversity and all. He said he didn't give a damn who sang at fanfare as long as it wasn't Buddy Killen. We meandered into a little bluegrass gathering. Uncle Dave Macon wondered out loud if he would ever get that high lonesome sound up there since Vince Gill is now gone gospel. Bill Monroe said he liked the picking of that kid in Nickel Creek, but what is it with that hair? Lester Flatt said if Marty Stewart's hair looked as good when he played with the Foggy Mountain Boys as it does now, he'd have slept with him. I saw Hee-Haw's Grandpa Jones. He gave me a big smile and a cranking handshake and said, Charlie, have you ever stopped to think and forget to start again? He also said String Bean had asked him several times, why is abbreviation such a long word? Doyle Wilburn said I should remind Kix Brooks to make sure nothing ever happens to Ronnie Dunn. We stopped at the Nashville Songwriters Association Heavenly Office, and sweet, sweet Maggie Cavender asked me to give all the songwriters a big kiss. And I told her no way was I ever going to kiss Glenn Sutton or Jerry Chestnut. While we were there, I noticed Colonel Tom Parker was in a corner trying to justify to Mayborn Action why Elvis was a co-writer on Heartbreak Hotel. Felice and Boodle O'Brien and Don Gent were on another cloud yelling at poor old Wesley Rose, and Felice was using words that she never used in any of her songs. I was really glad to see my old buddies, Audie Ashworth, Joe Allison, Biff Colley, and Wally Cochran. Biff said, "Charlie, you've aged a little since we met in 68. See, back then it was getting out to hip new joint. Wally said, "Yeah, now it's getting a new hip joint." Pretty Dottie West yelled from across the street, said, "Charlie, give my best to actress Demi Moore for checking out the younger men." I got a chance to tell Johnny Paycheck that a nice young man, John Grady, was running his old label, now Sony, and looks like he'll do a good job despite Mark Wright. Paycheck said, "Yeah, but when Billy Sherrill was a honcho, he did the work of three men, Curly, Larry, and Moe." Waylon said, "Hoss, watch this." He snapped his fingers, and all of a sudden, we were sitting in the Crystal Ballroom, the biggest honky-tonk I'd ever seen. The band was led by Grady Martin, included Larry London, Pete Drake, Joe Talbot, the Husky Boys, Don Rich, Jimmy Day, Shot and Tommy Jackson, Tommy Cogbill, with Dee Ford Bailey on the mouth harp and Jimmy Riddle on the eve. The singers were Bob Luman, Tammy Wynette, Mel Street, Marty Robbins, Webb Pierce, Red Foley, Patsy Montana, David Houston, Lefty Frizzell, Ernest Tubb, and Roy Acuff. The MCs were Grant Turner, T. Tommy Cutrer, and Bob Jennings. Sitting in the audience were Pee Wee King, Jim Cotton, Don Law, Tennessee Ernie Ford, Roy Orbison, Gene Autry, Roy and Dale, O.B. McClinton, Jerry Clower, Jack Anglin, new arrival Smiling Sheb Willie, Sam Phillips, Hawkshaw Hawkins, Lou DeWitt, Pappy Daly, and Tex Ritter. Tex was looking none too happy about me doing his bit. I told him that the world would miss his very funny son, John. Oh, by the way, sitting at the twin pianos were CMA Hall of Fame members Floyd Kramer and Owen Half Moon Bradley. Owen casually mentioned that he always knew he'd go to heaven because Harold worried the hell out of him. Roger Miller sneaked up behind me to ask if I knew when Willie Nelson might be coming to heaven. He said Willie'd been a lot higher than this many times. All of a sudden, I heard a big howdy, and up walked Cousin Minnie Pearl. She said, "Charlie, even though me and young Miller Harris are having a great time, it's good to see at least one more Methodist in heaven." She handed Waylon a copy of Music Row magazine and asked him to read the names of some really nice, nice country music folks that would be joining him in the next 100 years. Jimmy Gilmer, Frank Jones, David and Karen Conrad, Loretta Lynn, Jim Vieno, Chris and Shannon Neese, Peggy and Lou Bradley, Alan Mayer, Buzz Kaysen, Eddie Arnold, Barry and Joel Coburn, Charlie Pride, Michelle Berlin, Glenn Middleworth, Ray Eddington, Brian Schweitzer, Joe Walker Metter, Jimmy Bowen. All of a sudden, Waylon screamed a blood-curdling yell, "Bowen! No, not Bowen! Bowen is to country music what Osama bin Laden is to world peace." That's when I woke up, because I realized that Norrell Wilson, Porter Wagner, The Hag, Gene Watson, Troy Tomlinson, Randy Travis, Earl Thomas Conley, Joe Nichols, Joe Stampley, Alan Jackson, Keith Stegall, Eddie Stubbs, Leanne Womack, Frank Mull, Vern Gosden, Ricky Skaggs, Aaron Tippin, The Possum and me are still alive and working in country music. Okay, you may not know this, but I'm married to a woman. Don't laugh, that's not regular nowadays. Last week, Melissa Etheridge married a woman. I didn't know I had a chance or a choice. I'd marry Bill Gates anytime he asked me to. I'm really sorry my wife, Royce, is not here. She's gone to Iraq to teach Saddam how to fight dirty. However, she will be home in a few days. There's a big mall shopping fall sale at the Green Hills Mall. See, she and my two daughters made the all-mall team 3 years in a row out there. Bob Orman was born over 2,000 years ago in a manger. In my lifetime, we've gone from RKO pictures to RKO words. He's the co-author of Brenda Lee's biography with Brenda's beautiful daughter, Julie Clay, and with his beautiful wife, Mary Buffwack, the Women in Country Music. I'll sell these to you for $300. And he's the second best country music historian in the business, right behind me. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bob Orman.
Well, they tell me I'm to talk about what Nashville used to be like. And it did used to be a lot cooler and a lot funner. And as it is today, it was a lot of important women. The founding firm of the Nashville music business is, of course, Acuff Rose Publishing. Acuff, the Acuff in Acuff Rose was Mildred Acuff. The business was founded in her name in partnership with Fred Rose. Let me put it to you this way. I knew the Acuffs. One of them could balance a fiddle bow on his chin, and one of them could balance the books. I'll leave it to you to decide who was the brains of that couple. Acuff Rose stumbled along for several years until the year 1950, when the first professional songwriter moved to town. The first person who came here not to sing, not to play, but to write songs. It was a woman. Felice Bryant was her name. The second jewel in the crown of Nashville song publishing companies is, of course, Tree International. And as you will shortly hear, women were key to its success. And the woman that is the jewel in its crown today is with us tonight, Donna Hilly. Gradually through the early 1950s, the record companies began coming here. Mercury, Capitol, RCA, Decca, CBS, and Warner Brothers, in that order. All of these were very small operations. In those days, you would have about half a dozen people tops at a record company, and often a two-person operation. And one of those two people was the executive assistant, the woman that you had to get to know to get in the door. Owen Bradley had his, Chet Atkins had his, every single important person in this town, Jim Denny, you name all of the members of the Country Music Hall of Fame, beside every single one of those people was a capable and accomplished female executive. Once the sessions started happening, the studios were built. And managing every one of those studios in those days was a woman. The Nashville Symphony Orchestra was founded at this time by women. And all of the pieces of the puzzle that now make up the music business were put there by women. For instance, the support structures like BMI, which arrived in 1958 with Frances Preston, a woman, the founding of the NARIS office, headed by women, the founding of CSAC in 1964, headed for many years by Diane Petty, the founding in 1968 of the ASCAP office, which foundered for years before a woman took it over, Connie Bradley. (Clears throat) The founding in 1970 of the Nashville Songwriters Association by one of tonight's honorees, the late Maggie Cavender. And the founding of the Country Music Association in 1958 with an executive director who took it to greatness, Joe Walker Metter. In the 1970s, this process continued. In 1972, fanfare was inaugurated at the suggestion of women. The Disc Jockey Convention was founded at the suggestion of women. And the tourism business was guided by women. When the contemporary Christian music business came here in the 70s, its first major star was Amy Grant, a woman. And there's no real punchline to this story except to say that when we turned into the new millennium, this industry artistically and business-wise was ever more populated by capable and dynamic women. I guess the punchline is that who's following me is a great woman who's in the business today. And Charlie will bring her on. Thank you.
I do need your reverence for a moment. One day the Lord decided to visit the earth and take a stroll. Walking down the road, the Lord encountered a man who was crying. The Lord asked the man, "Why are you crying, my son?" The man said that he was blind and had never seen a sunset. The Lord touched the man, and the man could see, and he was happy. The Lord walked further. He met another man crying and asked, "Why are you crying, my son?" The man said that he was born a cripple and was never able to walk. The Lord touched him, and the man could walk, and he was happy. Further down the road, the Lord met another man crying and asked, "Why are you crying, my son?" The man said, "Lord, I work for Warner Brothers," and the Lord sat down and cried with him. Helped save his life. Her talent helped save his show. Here is the real foundation of the Jerry House Show, Devin O'Day.
When Pat Roth called and said, "Hey, Dev, what you doing?" You know, that's the first thing she ever says. But anyway, she said, "I want you to be part of this event, and it honors the women in the music industry, the history, the backbone of who we are." And she said, "Some of the women you'll know because they were in the forefront, and a lot of these women have never gotten their due because they worked in the background behind powerful men." I was all over that. Before I begin, I'd like to say thank you from the bottom of my heart for all of your prayers for the coolest man in the world, my dear friend Jerry House. God is so good, and he took care of my friend so that all the people who have bad days get to laugh, and I'm one of those people, so thank you. The first person that I would like to talk to you a little bit about, I had the great honor of knowing, Mary Margaret Maggie Polk Cavender. Oh my goodness, don't we all have a Maggie Cavender story? She went to Hume Fogg, and some of her career milestones, I love how they narrow it down to a couple. How do you do that? Maggie Cavender is a career milestone. She founded the Nashville Songwriters Association, the NSAI, became the first executive director. She started running Maggie Cavender Enterprises. Those were pretty big deals. Her first job in Nashville was with Pamper Music. She was hired by producer-songwriter-publisher Jack Clement. She worked at the CMA, helping to coordinate the first award show. The first award show. Isn't that, and look what it is today. She worked for Shelby Singleton. She became an administrator of Maypop Music, Alabama Band Music. And that just kind of starts the list of Maggie Cavender. Now, when I was given some of Maggie's information, I was sent part of her eulogy. Actually, this was written by one of the best poets ever to grace 16th Avenue. His name is Tom Schuyler. I hope you will bear with me because these were some of the most beautiful words, and I would like to share these with you. The conversations these days are familiar, but somehow more intense, perhaps more desperate. They are conversations that take place over coffee, lunch, studios, the phone, writing rooms, in the conference rooms. They are the conversations about music, about the artist, about the songs. We've all had them. We've been having them for years, and yes, somehow right now they've escalated. They are filled with fire and fury and passion. Now that we've arrived here at the pinnacle of our success, why do we feel so empty and so hollow? Why is it all so safe? Why is it all the same? Why are we not taking chances? Why are the chances taken disregarded? Why is the tail wagging the dog? Why does this community feel fractured? Who has backed this wonderfully creative community into a corner and held it ransom? Who's not speaking up? Who's not being heard? What happened to our first love? I am honored and humbled to stand before you this morning and participate in the celebration of the glorious and meaningful life of our friend and companion, Maggie Cavender. My comments about the anxious murmuring that lies right beneath the surface of our community are not meant to set the stage for any personal or political agenda. I mention them rather to serve as a reflecting pool, if you will, of a life that made a difference. A life that helped shape the lives of others, a life that helped bring respect and dignity to the most significant link in our creative chain. A life that had passion and energy and opinions and agendas. A life that had compassion. A life that had reason. As I've come to understand and appreciate the meaning of the word, Maggie Cavender was truly a character. She had her own unique look, that slight frame, stylishly adorned, upright and graceful, more than not billowed in smoke, and always, always topped off with what must have been 100 hats. She had her own unique aura, at once both mysterious and approachable. Irreverent and humble, forceful yet gentle, the servant leader, the cantankerous sweetheart. She carried herself in her own way, at ease with and always available to both industry leaders and struggling songwriters. And most importantly, perhaps the essence of what I would humbly put forth here this morning, Maggie had her own unique voice. The sound of Maggie's voice alone spoke volumes. It possessed the edge of experience, the experience of the South, of high society, of good and happy times, the experience of struggle, of turmoil, real life, the experience of good and bad habits, the experience of argument and of peacemaking. The sound of Maggie's voice was immediately identifiable. If Maggie would have been a singer, you could have picked her out in the middle of a 12 in a row. The sound of Maggie's voice demanded attention. It had a roughness, and at times it seemed a little stern, a little harsh. But regardless of the texture, the words that crossed her tongue were filled with benevolence, with wisdom, passion, and spirit. There was a vision in Maggie's voice, a vision with which all of us in this room and many more had to deal with, and thank goodness she spoke up. Maggie made us mad. She frustrated us and argued with us, and in most conversations I had with her, I could actually see the wheels turning in her mind before she responded. She was guarded and protective. She was smart and cunning. She liked things her way. She had opinions, and she had an agenda. And it has been my experience that her agenda was this: making life better for people like you and me, lifting us up, giving us a voice, a purpose, and dignity. It was her energy, spirit, zeal that inspired many other notable, wonderful people in this town to fashion, create, and organize the platform upon which we all stand, and to demand respect and recognition. The Nashville Songwriters Association International is as vital and effective an organization as I have ever encountered. It was Maggie Cavender's dream that started it, and her spirit is indelibly etched into its very fiber. May it never, ever cease. So that in that spirit and in honor of our dear, dear friend, I challenge each of us as we wallow and wander in our current crisis of identity to speak up, have opinions, to rail against the powers, to be robust, to put up with it, to not put up with it, to have an agenda, to get after it, to do it with dignity, with class, and with honor. So, dear Maggie, do go gently into that good night. You have fought the good fight. Rest now in God's everlasting arms, because you have shown us so much, cared about us so deeply. You've been and always will be a treasure to your family and to those of us who have gathered in this room, because you let the world know that it all begins with a song, and your sweet Maggie was a beautiful one. And now with that, I would like to bring the person who is going to accept her award, Bart Herbison, to the stage.
Over just the past few months, NSAI stopped a compulsory license bill in Washington, D.C. that would have cost music publishers and songwriters hundreds of millions of dollars over the years. In January, we argued and won a case in the United States Supreme Court that keeps 20 extra years on songwriters' copyrights. Yesterday, we returned from Washington, D.C., where we had 40 songwriters lobbying members of Congress this entire week. We're about to introduce legislation, I'm optimistic it's going to pass, that will give songwriters capital gains when they sell their catalogs, an extra 35 cents on the dollar in their bank account, and some legislation that will help stop frivolous lawsuits. And songwriters from right here in Nashville have taken the forefront in the media campaign against anti-piracy and illegal downloading. None of that would have happened without Maggie Cavender, because there would be no NSAI without Maggie Cavender. And if it all began with a song, it all began with Maggie. I've asked two of her dearest friends to join me, and if I could introduce Cheryl Blackmon.
I had the unique honor of working with Maggie for several years. She helped me tremendously. If she was here tonight, she would be deeply honored, and she would also be very adamant in letting everybody know that there's still a lot more work to be done on behalf of songwriters. Thank you.
And I know who Maggie would want to get and keep this award. It's Mr. Tom Long.
Thank you, Bart. There's a lot you could say about Maggie Cavender. She was a very dear friend of mine. I knew her for a lot of years, and I think with her help, I became the president of the Nashville Songwriters Association in 83 when I was working at Tree Publishing. We traveled a lot of miles together and endured a lot of smoke and a lot of airplanes together from her cigarettes, but a lot of memories. But there was three people that were dear to Maggie in her life, I think, and Pete, her husband, was number one, The Songwriters was number two, and Braves Baseball was number three. And we attended a lot of Braves games together. Every year we'd go down to the Georgia Music Hall of Fame Awards, and we'd always go about a week early so we could go to Bill Lowry's party on Wednesday evenings. She always wanted to attend that, and we always went to the Braves game, usually the next night or the next two nights, and then the Georgia Music Hall of Fame Awards. And we always had rooms next to each other, and we always had to have a joining door so she could have the coffee on, and she would knock on the door. So Belinda, who's here with me tonight, my lovely wife, and we'd always sit and have coffee and drink and talk about songwriters. Got a lot of memories about Maggie. She's very dear to me, and Pete was as well. And I just wish she could be here with us tonight so we could see what kind of hat she would be wearing. So, but anyway, they gave me this medallion that should go to Maggie, but I didn't feel worthy enough to put it on. I think it should be around the necks of every songwriter that's ever walked the streets of Nashville, Tennessee. Thank you.
Next posthumous award goes to Joyce Bush. 1951, she was working at WSM with Jack Stapp, who was program director at the radio as well as the Grand Ole Opry. According to Buddy Killen, Joyce was very bright, just a kid, and very dedicated to her job as an executive secretary and assistant to Jack Stapp. Now, when Jack left WSM for KDA, Joyce continued working with him. During that period, Loke Howan, a media executive, approached Jack Stapp with an offer to back him in a music publishing venture. The company opened, and it was named Tree. In 1954, Jack Stapp hired Buddy Killen. In 1957, Loke Howan sold out Tree to Jack Stapp, and the sale was noted by the company's secretary, none other than Joyce Bush. After Jack became sole owner, he gave Buddy Killen 30% of the company, gave 10% to Joyce Bush, according to the book 50 Years of Inspiration. Joyce became an important face in the early history of Tree. She was a strong, able administrator who always had gentle words for hardworking, competitive songwriters. Joyce got to work with writers like Roger Miller, who was writing for Tree in the mid-60s. Buddy Killen had signed Roger Miller to Smash Records in 1957. Jerry Kennedy produced all of Roger's hit records on that label. Joyce also worked with writers Bobby Braddock, Don Wayne, Bill Anderson, Sonny Throckmorton, Curly Putnam, Rafe Van Hoy, Bucky Jones, Justin Tubb, and a guy named Donnie Young. You might know him as Johnny Paycheck, Ed Bruce, Red Lane. During that period, they worked with Joe Tex, who was on Dial Records. Joyce Bush's presence was so critical to the company that after she became ill, Buddy and Jack brought into the company Joyce's hand-picked successor, Donna Hilly, who was working at the time with Bill Hudson Advertising. I think she made a good choice, don't you? Joyce Bush died in 1974 after a long struggle with cancer, and it was a heartbreaking moment in Tree music publishing history. And Donna Hilly is accepting the award for Joyce Bush.
I had the privilege of working with Joyce Bush for 9 years at WKDA Radio. She became truly my best friend. And then one day she said she was going to work at Tree full time and that I could either have a choice of going to Tree or going to work for Bill Hudson and handling the Tree account. So I chose to go with Bill Hudson and handle the Tree account. Joyce and I took our vacations together, she and Carter Ray and Rayford and I, and we were just the closest of friends. And she was truly, I mean, she was in love with Tree. I mean, she really, really was. And then one day, Bill and I got called to Jack's office in 1974. on a Friday afternoon at 5 o'clock, and those of you who work know that if you're going to get fired, you get fired at 5 o'clock on Friday afternoon. I looked at Bill, I said, have you done something? No. Have you done something? No. So anyway, she wanted to tell me that she was not going to make it with cancer. She knew that, and she wanted to give me her job. I said, Joyce, I don't know anything about publishing. She said, it doesn't matter, you will learn. So, you know, I know she's looking down tonight, and I can tell you there are a lot of things that the music industry knows about Joyce, but I have to tell you two really stories that tell you about the heart of Joyce Bush. Those of you who've been in Nashville a long time know that, you know, back in the early days, you know, I'm old as God, they had a home called the Florence Crittenden Home. And that was a home for unwed mothers. And, you know, today it's unusual if you get married to have a baby. But back then, you know, your mother told you it was going to have a mongoloid baby if you got pregnant before you married. You know, you just didn't do that. But the Florence Crittenden Home was a wonderful place for unwed mothers. So one day I was going over to Joyce's office to handle something, and there had to be 25 pregnant women in tree stuffing envelopes. And I went in there and I said, Joyce, what is this? And she said, well, these girls don't have anything. So she said, this is who we get to mail out all of our things. And she was paying them to give them spending money. Another time she called me one day and she said, you know, she said, there's a nursing home here that doesn't have air conditioners. And so she said, we've asked all the writers and all the staff to sort of pitch in and give some money. And she had actually raised the money to give 15 air conditioners for people that, you know, that didn't have any cool air. So Joyce Bush was an incredible executive, but she had an even bigger heart for humanity. So I know she's looking down, and I gladly accept this on her behalf with great honors.
Might I add, Donna, that you have held up her end of the legacy very well. Mary Bridges Lynch Jarvis. Mary was born on October 17th, 1930 in Franklin, and she came from a musical family. As a teenager, she sang and played the piano for two quartets, frequently throughout Tennessee, Alabama, and Kentucky. She also was a pianist at the Franklin Cumberland Presbyterian Church during her teen years, all the way until her death in 1995. Mary also served as president of the Statesman Quartet Fan Club, so it's no surprise that Mary chose a career in the music industry. Mary's career in the music industry spanned 34 years, including tenures as executive assistant to Chet Atkins at RCA and to Fred Foster at Monument Records. Mary was well-loved and respected by all of the artists and musicians at the labels. Waylon Jennings wrote in his autobiography about Mary keeping him out of trouble with Chet. Boy, that was a job, wasn't it? When Mary left Monument Records, Fred Foster said, if she's leaving for any reason other than marrying Felton Jarvis, I'll chain her to her desk. She wed famed record producer and Georgia Music Hall of Fame member Felton Jarvis on July 20th, 1969. She devoted her years with Felton to helping him with his business as Elvis Presley's exclusive record producer, and also took care of Felton through his many health problems. Now, he died on January 2nd, 1981. Mary devoted her life from then on to keeping Felton's memory alive and successfully had RCA Liz Felton as producer on Elvis's recordings, as well as overseeing his display at the Georgia Music Hall of Fame. Mary was devoted to her family, her church, and her community. She was the first female elder at her church. She was the clerk of the session and served 6 years on the Board of Missions. She also was quite involved with the National Kidney Foundation and received the Cecil Gillum Award for Volunteer Services and Distinguished Service. Now, Mary was diagnosed with cancer in October of 1994, and she died on June 6th of the following year. Her family, her friends, and all of us miss her very much. And I know that members of her family are going to accept for her. Mary Bridges Lynch Jarvis.
On behalf of the family of Mary Lynch Jarvis, I would like to thank the Source Foundation for honoring her with this award. I know she'd be very proud to be honored along with all these other wonderful ladies that are being honored tonight, but if you knew her, she wasn't a person who liked a lot of fuss made about her, so she'd probably think it's a little bit too much, but she liked to do things for people without a lot of recognition. But the two most important things to her were her church, where she played piano like no one you ever heard, and her family, who she was a tower of strength for all of us, and especially Uncle Felton. And she was a very special lady, and we really want to thank you from the bottom of our heart for honoring her here tonight. Thank you.
Oh, I love this. I love this so much because this is our history. You know, I came to Nashville after starting in radio in 1977 in a little rural town in Louisiana, and I wanted to be in the music business. I didn't know what I wanted to be, but I hope that many years from now, the career that I've had in music can even have an inkling and stand up just to a little bit of what these women have done. Our next honoree is Mary Irene Flowers Stanton. Irene Stanton, born in Columbia, Tennessee. When she was a small child, her family moved to Nashville, and she attended local schools and graduated from Hume Fogg High School. She attended business college in order to become, well, what did all women at that time go to college to become? Secretaries. Her love of rhythm was evidenced by her singing and dancing. She studied dancing and participated in local community theater. Her piano instruction was by a neighborhood piano teacher born in Berlin and trained in Vienna. In 1944, Irene married Charles Dobb Stanton, and they made their home in Miami, Florida, where she became secretary to the city manager, and then he later became captain of the Miami Police Department. After several years of city employment, Irene resigned and became a homemaker and an avid political campaigner. She and Charles built an orchid greenhouse at their home in the Everglades. They go around the Everglades seeking all the rare orchids. Now, following her husband's untimely death in 1956, Irene turned to music as a solace. For the next 5 years, she traveled back and forth between family in Nashville and her home in Miami. And during that time, she wrote endlessly, perfecting her lyricist skills. At her family home on Woodlawn Drive in Nashville, a recorder remained on the piano for years. Irene moved back to Nashville in 1961. And she presented her songwriting efforts to Don Law at Columbia Records, who was pretty impressed with her talent, sent her to Jim Denny over at Cedarwood Publishing Company. Mr. Denny signed her to a writer's contract and assigned Wayne Walker, an outstanding guitarist, to work with Irene. Now together, Wayne and Irene turned out hit songs like Unloved, Unwanted, Pride, Stranger, Ancient History, Loving Arms, A Day That Saved the World, Imitation, Just Forget Me, and You Warned Me. These songs are recorded by people like Ray Price and Johnny Cash, Lefty Frizzell, Anita Bryant, The Jordanaires, Jimmy Dean, Billy Walker, Marion Worth, Dean Martin, Jerry Lynn, Claude King, Bill Purcell, and Kitty Wells. In 1961, Irene was hired by Don Law to work with him and Frank Jones in the A&R department. When Mr. Law retired from Columbia Records in 1967, he and Irene formed Don Law Productions, which has been in operation for 36 years. They established the publishing company, CV Music. They came from her years of living, looking at the sea down in Miami. From that catalog, For the Good Times won a Grammy. I won't mention it again, was CMA Album of the Year. Prior to Don Law's death in 1982, he sold stock in both companies to Irene, who served as president and CEO until her death in 2001. Lifelong Democrat, Irene was active in local political campaigns, inserting much energy and financial support. She and her sister, Dr. Emma Flowers, enjoyed browsing bookstores, greenhouses, boutiques, and I love this, gravel pits where they look for fossils, and numerous other leisure pursuits. Irene was an ardent environmentalist and nature lover. Her hilltop home in the Hillwood area of Nashville contained virgin forest and a haven for wildlife. She subscribed to numerous nature and conservation magazines and contributed to animal protection organizations. Wishing that both Don Law Productions and CB Music could continue operation,
Irene willed both companies to her sister, Dr. Flowers. These companies continue to be profitable and enjoy domestic and international sales. We'd like to welcome that sister, Dr. Emma Flowers, to accept.
Well,
oh, how beautiful. On behalf of my sister, I would like to accept this. She would have been greatly appreciative of it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for allowing me to bestow these honors and to talk about these amazing, incredible women.
Excuse me, I just found out tonight, and I don't know when, but Roy Horton of Pier Music passed away. Frank, when?
Night before last.
Night before last, so some of you knew Roy. He had was a song plugger extraordinary. Also, I'd like to introduce our little Vanna White here. Her name is Claire Watson. She's just doing a marvelous little job. No, she works with Kay. It's of no particular interest, but she's married to a guy from my hometown. My mother raised her in-laws. No big deal, but you don't know a hell of a lot of people from Geneva, Alabama, do you? I'm one of them. Now, she is Nashville's first international female superstar. She's one of the sweetest ladies I've ever had the pleasure of knowing, and the women like her to show up with her good-looking husband, Ronnie. Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome my dear friend, Brenda Lee.
Thank you so much. I see so many folks here tonight that I love, and I'm so glad to be in their company. A few months ago, my best friend in high school, and also my best friend today, Kay Smith, called me, and yes, called me and asked me to be a part of this evening, and it just tickles me to death to be here at this event to honor the ladies of Music Row. I'm proud to say that I've known each one of them, and I so appreciate their hard work and their dedication that they've given to our industry. Their contributions are just immeasurable. And when I tell you what, whenever I needed anything of any of the companies or any of the individuals that these ladies represented, I always went to the very head of the stream. I called the girls, and I always got what I needed. So it is a pleasure for me to be tonight. It's an honor for me to be here to honor them. And the first lady that I would like to honor, I guess I've known her ever since she came to town, Loreen Linville Allen. She was born in Hominy, Oklahoma. She graduated valedictorian in her class. For 10 years, she was the only female oil executive with Sunray DX Oil Company in Tulsa. And because of her husband's encouragement, because of Harold's encouragement and challenge to apply her lyrical abilities to country songwriting, they came to Nashville. She applied her business skills working in the Wilburn Brothers office in 1967, where she met Loretta Lynn. She later worked for Capitol Records with George Ritchie and Larry Butler, who she also co-wrote with. In 1969, Loretta started her own publishing company, and Mooney Lynn hired Loreen to manage their businesses. In spite of her busy role as a businesswoman, her songwriting never wavered. She's had over 50 songs recorded by major artists. She's mostly remembered for The Pill by Loretta Lynn, which was a groundbreaking record, if you remember. Other of her recordings include That's All That's Left of My Baby, recorded by Eddie Arnold, Cal Smith, Dottie West, Nat Stuckey, and Jimmy Dean. Everything Begins and Ends with You by Sonny James and Pat Boone. If You're With Me, the Wilburn Brothers and Ferlin Husky. If We Put Our Heads Together, a duet by Loretta Lynn and Ernest Tubb. And Out of Consideration, Don Gibson and Loretta Lynn. Her personal favorite, she's always said, has not been recorded. And the name of that is Thanks for an Uneventful Day. Well, Loreen, today is pretty eventful. And we are so glad that you are here to accept this honor. It gives me great pride to present it to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Loreen Allen.
To name, but it's good to know that so many care. Thank you very much.
Can I hold this up?
Can I say one thing?
Yes.
I just want to say one thing. All of you know my mom, and I've always thought she was the best of the best, and I thank Source for recognizing her. And if you just knew what a wonderful night it was for my family, my daughter and her husband, my son and his fiance, my dad's here with her. They've been married 50-some years. And today I found out my mom's going to be a great-grandmother of a little girl. And in a month, my son's marrying a wonderful young lady. So it's just a wonderful way to sort of round everything out. And she is just a wonderful woman, and I wouldn't be where I am without her. And I also want to thank my husband for being here. He's a wonderful, wonderful addition to our family of a year. So thank you, Ron.
Somebody asked me if I would do my Brooks and Dunn imitation. Harry Ann Condrew was born in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Her father, Bernie Moore, was head football coach at LSU and later became commissioner of the Southeastern Conference. She graduated from the University of Alabama and is an alumna of the Leadership Music. She has a daughter and two grandchildren. Harry Ann has enjoyed a long-time affiliation with the world of country music. While in her first position at WSM in the early 50s, she made an early and historic contribution with her suggestion for the annual disc jockey convention to celebrate the anniversary of the Grand Ole Opry. My first trip to Nashville was 1957, Harry Ann II, that disc jockey convention. In 1970, WSM honored her for that suggestion. In 75, Jack Stapp hired Harry Ann for Tree's copyright department. As Nashville's music grew in popularity, Harry Ann became director of copyright administration. Tree later sold Sony ATV and sent Harry Ann as the copyright emissary to all over the world to talk about Sony Tree and to get their money. During her tenure at Tree, Harry Ann was one of the foremost authorities on music publishing copyright.
Thank you.
Brenda,
I want to thank Source for this wonderful honor. It is it has been such a pleasure for me to look forward to this, and such an honor to me to receive it. I want to thank Donna Healy, who actually is the one who brought me to Tree. She was my mentor. She had faith in me. And I told her when she hired me, I said, I don't know anything about copyright. And she said, oh, you'll learn. That's just like Donna. You'll learn. And I just love her so much. She has been such a great friend of mine. And I am so thrilled to be here tonight, not only to be able to say how much I appreciate her, but to say how much I appreciate Source and Pat Roth for putting on this wonderful thing. Thank you.
Next recipient, I could stand up here all night long, I guess, and talk about. There's so many funny stories and funny times that we have shared through the years. I've known her since I first went with my recording company, with the great Owen Bradley, who was my producer for many, many years. What can I say about Polly Roper Eddington? In 1960, Polly started working for Chet Atkins at RCA Records, whose office was located in the small building that was Studio A. A memorable experience she recalled was when Elvis came in to record, which was usually on a Sunday night, and she was allowed to come in to fill up the Coke machine and talk to Elvis. I bet she did, too. In 1962, Polly worked briefly with Floyd Kramer and Grady Martin, two of my loves of my life. That job consisted mainly of watching Superman on TV and drinking champagne with Grady every afternoon. From 1962 to 1968, Polly was a secretary at Columbia Records and hiring for some of the recording sessions. In 1968, she worked for Owen Bradley at Decca as secretary bookkeeper. Owen was producing anywhere from 40 to 50 artists, including Patsy Cline and myself. And they were booking around 25 record sessions at a time, and Polly was consumed with record contracts, liaison with 200 or more song pluggers who wanted Owen's time, as well as audition tape correspondence. In addition, she served as coordinator of Decca's involvement with the disc jockey convention. In 1975, the love bug bit, and Polly and Ray Eddington married, and Polly retired. And we couldn't believe it. But retirement didn't take. And in 1978, Polly re-entered the business and worked until 1991. Most of that time was spent with the great Floyd Kramer as secretary bookkeeper, booking record sessions, booking his band, hiring local orchestra musicians for road dates, and organizing Floyd's annual golf tournaments. She is one of the funniest people that I know, and certainly one of the most straightforward. I love her to death. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to honor tonight, and Source is proud to honor, Polly Roper Eddington.
Thank you. thank you so much, Source. This is the most wonderful moment of my life. I was very privileged to work for three of the best, as you've heard, Owen Bradley, Chet Atkins, and Floyd Kramer. I wish I could thank them.
Next lady of Music Row, I've known for just about as long as I've known Polly, and that is Cecile Light. In June of 1967, shortly after immigrating to the U.S. from Italy, Cecile was offered two positions in the music industry. One was with Tandy Rice, who was president of Showbiz, and the other was with Jerry Bradley at Bradley's Barn and Forest Hills Music. Jerry offered $5 more a week, so she took it. Her salary was a big whopping $55 a week. And this is interesting. These are things that were happening during that period. Women were not allowed to wear pants to work. A songwriter's contract was printed on one single sheet of paper. A state-of-the-art recording console was an 8-track. A girl's best friend was an IBM Selectric. And lunch at Marchetti's was 65 cents. Bradley's barn at one time, believe it or not, was a real barn with cows and manure, and it was purchased by Owen in 1964 after selling the famous Quonset hut. While working there, she was instrumental in the sessions of Loretta Lynn, Eddie Arnold, Ernest Tubb, Art Garfunkel. Okay, Cecile. Okay. Myself, Burl Ives, Joan Baez, Kitty Wells, Leon Russell, Marty Robbins, Pete Fountain, Roy Orbison, The Who, and numerous others, including movie soundtracks of Coal Miner's Daughter and Sweet Dreams. After fire destroyed the barn in 1980, it was rebuilt and sessions continued with George Jones, Keith Richards, and many more. During this time, she was also assisting Jerry Bradley with Forest Hills Music, whose original writers were Jan Crutchfield, David Briggs, and Ellie White. In 1986, when Jerry Bradley became president of Acuff Rose Music, Cecile continued on with Jerry as executive assistant. She had 16 fabulous years working with some of the top writers in town. Acuff Rose Publishing was sold to Sony ATV in 2002, and Cecile retired from the music industry. We all love her. We're proud to honor her tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Cecile Light.
I just want to say thank you to Source for the honor. I also want to thank Jerry Bradley and his family for 36 years of friendship. It's been a wonderful life.
Cecile also didn't like the way my pictures were hung on my wall, so she went and rearranged them one day, too. Before we finish tonight, I'd like to tell the honorees tonight, the living honorees, we'd like them all, everybody's accepting tonight to be up here, but we'd like to have the living honorees first to come over here in this little collective kind of place, and let's get a photo. So don't stop them real quick. Let them get over here and let's get the pictures, and then we're going to have the bar open again, and we'll have a little festivity here afterwards. Let them get them over here, and then we also want the people who represented people, and then we'll do a group thing. Let's do the living one first. Now, does everybody understand that? That's not too damn hard to remember. In 1965, Charlotte Lowther started her music industry career at Acuff Rose in the Hickory Records office for Lester Rose and Dee Kilpatrick, then as Wesley Rose's secretary. In 73, Don Gant left Acuff Rose for ABC Records and hired Charlotte as his office manager. In 75, ABC bought Dot Records. Jim Fogelsong was put in charge. Don left for a position at Tree, and he asked Charlotte to go work with him, thus beginning her 20 years with Tree. Charlotte took a medical leave from Tree from 1980 to 81. Don left Tree during that period, so Charlotte returned to Tree as secretary to Buddy Killen, who was at that time in charge. During that time, Jack Stapp passed away, and Buddy sold Tree to Sony. Charlotte became assistant secretary and friend to Miss Donna Healy, who became president of Sony Tree. And that friendship continued until Charlotte's retirement in 96 and continues to this day. Charlotte feels fortunate to have worked with artists and writers such as Roy Orbison, the New Beats, Don Gibson, Jimmy Buffett, Mickey Newberry, Roy Acuff, Bobby Blue Band, a little Bobby Blue Band, John D. Loudermilk, Curly Putman, Bobby Braddock, T.G. Shepherd, Jamie O'Hara, Ferlin Husky, Red Stewart and Pee Wee King, and on and on and on. A great 30 years, she says, with great people and lots of fun and laughter. Charlotte lost her son Jason to an automobile accident in 78. Her daughter Diane and husband live in Philadelphia. She has three grandchildren. Charlotte loves include travel, reading, bridge, word games, water, and spending time with her many good friends. She has a chronic pulmonary disease, which requires oxygen around the in case you think she's sniffing something that's not legal. After her husband Campbell died in 98, she bought a condo cottage somewhere near me in Green Hills and graciously extends an invitation to you to come see me. Would you welcome my pretty little friend, Charlotte Lowther, ladies and gentlemen. Steps
to it.
You've got the box. You need to hold. Let me hold this, darling, for
okay.
you.
Okay. This is just a wonderful occasion. It's delightful to see the friends that I had on the road and still have, whether I see them often or not. And to those of you that don't know us, you honor us by being here. We appreciate it. Thank you to Source and all of its members and for all of you. Thank you very much. And it's just a wonderful night.
Thank you, darling.
It's just beautiful. Love it.
Good. Before I turn it over to Brenda again, Bob Orman, I think his name, he said that we're going to have Nashville Star again. I think it's going to be great for Nashville. I wish you all well, okay?
Our last honoree tonight is Emily Mitchell. In October of 1966, Emily had no idea what a ride she was about to take with Billy Sherrill in the pilot seat. On Epic Records, David Houston was topping all the charts with Almost Persuaded, and Tammy Wynette had been in the previous day when Billy gave her apartment number 9 to learn. Emily's first assignment was to book the session for the next day. Over the next 17 years, Emily was Billy Sherrill's right arm, progressing from secretary to manager of A&R CBS Records Nashville. Emily says that she did everything Billy didn't want to do. She said he's such a creative person that he left the majority of the business matters to her unless it required his personal attention. In practice, Emily was the conduit through which information passed between Billy and the outside world. Often she would act as an intermediary between Billy and the artist or musicians, and they would thrash out problems or details with her first, then she would pass it on for Billy's stamp of approval. Emily left CBS Records in August of 1982 with the intention of taking some time off from the music industry. That abruptly ended in October when Al Gallico asked her to run his Nashville office. In 1986, Gallico relocated his publishing corporation from New York to California and closed his local branch office. Emily finally stepped off the music business merry-go-round. She says it was hectic, exciting, fun, but it was time to do some things just for her. Emily was instrumental in the careers of artists that Billy Sherrill produced, such as Tammy Wynette, George Jones, David Houston, David Allen Coe, Tanya Tucker, Joe Stampley, Charlie Rich, Bobby Vinton, and the list goes on. We're proud to honor her tonight. Source is proud to honor her, Emily Mitchell.
Charlie said for me to tell y'all he still looked good, so I'm telling you, he still looks good. Thank you all so much. This has been a wonderful, wonderful night, and it's about time there is a Source. However, if there had been a Source when I first started, we could have probably all met at Marchetti's because there weren't that many people around then. But this has been really delightful. I'm sure it is not the last. It's just the first and just the beginning. I mean, the response has been unbelievable. And I think everybody has really appreciated everything all these gals have done. I mean, this has been a lovely, lovely night. And thank you all for coming.
I just want to say thank you once again to Kay and all the ladies that worked so very hard to put this together tonight. It's not often that we artists get to thank the people behind the scenes because we're all being pulled so many different ways, but these ladies tonight are truly deserving. I have enjoyed my friendship with all of them. They've treated me so great through the years, and I appreciate being a part of this wonderful evening. Thank you so much.
Don't you dare move. Kay, come here a minute. Come here, Kay. Give a big round of applause for Kay Smith, who has done. Hey, the committee, come up here a minute. Let's see the faces of the committee. Come on. Let's see the faces. Come on. I think somebody should say something here. Kay, they have a little gift for you. Judy Harris. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were leaving for a drink, Judy. I wasn't sure.
Not without you.
This is for all the ladies that I've admired for so many years. There's many more. There'll be a 2, there'll be a 50 year. Ladies. Holly, thank you for not hiring me.
Nobody wanted to talk, so I guess it would be me. Kay Smith, you have been our leader through this. You have absolutely just been right there for all of us. And it was Kay's idea, and she pulled it off, didn't she?
Yay! Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, I love hanging around with the girls. I'm glad my wife didn't come because I can spend more time with the girls. But thank you for coming again. Let the living honorees, please get through the maze to get over here, and we'll have a few pictures. And thank you. I hope you had a great time. The bar's going to open. You can make some donations and get some drinks, okay? Anything else? That it? Yeah. Big round of applause once again.
Thank you, Charlie Monk.
Thank you, Charlie Monk. I'm sorry.
Bye,
My, it's been a long, long time. How am I doing? Oh, I guess that I'm doing fine. It's been so long now, and it seems that it was only yesterday. Gee, ain't it funny?